everybody. It's Lynn from WisconsinGarden.com. And this is mid-August, and we thought we'd take you on a mid-August garden tour. Just sitting here, I was trying to think, what has changed since our last tour, which was in the middle of July? We've raised a couple of black swallow caterpillars to their butterfly state. Our dahlias have begun opening. We've eaten our first tomatoes that are nice now and ripe. Cucumbers, peppers, squash. Many of our flowers are blossoming. It's wonderful to see the transition from spring when all you have is daffodils and some tulips and some anemones, and then you go into the bleeding hearts, and now we are into the sunflowers and the dahlias and the marigolds and the liatris. Well, liatris actually is getting toward the end. So we just wanted to walk around and share how different it is from last month. We thought we'd start in our northern raised beds, and this is the area we designated as the fenced-in area for things like peppers and carrots. We had beans in here, green beans. Those are done now, so I've taken them out. We still have a couple of tomatoes that are doing very well. Slow but sure. Beets behind. If these beets were not in here, the deer and the rabbits would have done away with them, as well as our carrots. These are our rainbow carrots, and I don't know if I can even get them out of the ground at this point because I haven't loosened up the soil, and I don't want to pull them out and lose half my carrots, but they're purple, white, yellow, orange. Very, very good. Very sweet. So we enjoyed doing those, and then I have some behind that are stubbier ones. That is a turkey. It's having a good old bath. I wonder if Eva knows about him. Now, as the summer goes along, the tomatoes get taller and taller, and that's why we put them in cages, because if they were just lying all over the ground, there'd be more insect eating of things. So these are boxcar willies, which are big tomatoes. Very good. These are a heirloom variety.
Are these indeterminate?
Yes, they are. Look, and they're taller than I. Even if I were standing up here, they would be even with me. But they're good. You can tell it's the end of the summer because you will have some leaves that have turned, and I've chopped a bunch off that, you know, just were brown. And behind them are eggplant. This is a thin Japanese variety, and then that one is developing a big black beauty. End of the summer is interesting also for doing squash. Now, they've been growing since early June, and of course they get bigger and bigger. This is a Getty squash. This is a squash that was found in an archaeological dig in Green Bay several years back. They found a clay pot that had some seeds in it. They look like squash seeds, so when they planted them, that's the squash that came out. It was amazingly large and amazingly orange, and eventually, after they grew some themselves, they started selling them, and they were selling them for $1 a seed. One seed cost $1. So we bought some, and this is our second year. Last year, it didn't get this big, but we saved some of the seeds, and this is how it's progressed so far. So it's going to be interesting to try eating it and see if we even like it, but it's definitely an interesting thing to grow.
Well, it's definitely much larger than the one we had last year, too.
Yes, so. It is. Well, it's got more sun, and it's got more space to spread out.
Yep.
Over here, we have spaghetti squash. Love spaghetti squash. They're ready to pick, and once they turn golden like that, if you haven't had spaghetti squash before, it's like, well, it's vegetable spaghetti. That's what more can I say? It's delicious, and it's very good for you, and it doesn't add a whole lot of carbs to your spaghetti. Then we also have over here, down in here, we have zucchini. There's some more over there. And there's some more over there.
And then
beyond that, we have butternut, yes, and also another zucchini and a yellow neck squash.
Where's my delicata?
Well, that's over there too. We have to go on the other side.
Oh, okay.
One of Rick's all-time favorite, the delicata Zeppelin squash. Down here, it's in the pack of colors. When it's finished, it's yellow and green, and it's very creamy. It's a winter squash, so they do last long into the winter, as well as enjoying them right now. And then down here are the butternut squash, which are also winter squash. So I still have one or two of these down in the basement from last year.
Yeah. Well, I may have a couple more.
Mm-hmm. Now, early in the season, before it even should have been here, we had powdery mildew, which often occurs on squash, but usually it's later in the season. But this year, because it was so humid all the time, it developed early, and I did spray it, and I think that helped a lot. And I've also been out here chopping off leaves that are truly very mildewy and throwing them in the garbage, not in my compost. When you eat a squash and you take the seeds out of it, you want to throw them in your compost bin. Well, sometimes they end up growing and creating another plant for you. So I'm not quite sure what those are. We'll see. But it should be interesting.
So you're recycling your compost bin?
Yes. It does it by itself. This was our surprise tree. As some of you may remember, when we were trimming, we have always thought this was a plum tree. And when we trimmed it, it definitely enjoyed being trimmed, and lo and behold, it turned out to be a plum tree.
Pear.
See, I'm already calling it a pear tree. It's a pear tree.
Where's the partridge?
Now, that is a plum. And we did have one. And I thought I saw one more up there.
Well, that's all because we really cut it back. But again, I think we're going to have to cut it back even more.
Yes, we will. Early in the spring, late winter, when it's dormant. This is our nice, peaceful, quiet area. Sometimes I just come and sit and watch the pond and the fish floating around in there, and the frogs that are hiding near the lily ponds. And as you walk over here, they see you way before you even get here and hop in and squeak at you. But that's fun. I like that. This climbing spinach has been fun. Several years ago, we bought one at the plant sale and fell in love with it. Even though we're not big spinach eaters, it was just such a beautiful plant with this burgundy stem and the green leaves. And then it develops these beautiful flowers. And those seeds can be saved and replanted, so it's an heirloom. Last year we didn't get to planting them, and we didn't have a plant sale, and I thought, oh no, we're not going to have any climbing spinach. And then waited a little bit while longer and realized it had planted itself. So I was able to share not only some of the leaves, but also some of the plants. Looking at the waterfall today, and we haven't turned it on today. We've kind of let the fish every now and again take a little calm day with no force flowing through. This lower part here, this big part, is the one that we are going to be replacing once the weather turns cooler. It has to be rebuilt so that it'll be sturdy and last 50 more years.
Only 50?
That'll be long enough.
You want to stick around and watch it?
Sure.
Okay.
You know how every summer there is an area that you think you're going to get to, but you never do? That's this area this summer. We have been so concentrated on other areas, we never even got to spread our mulch. The Rudbeckia, black-eyed Susans, have just kind of taken over. The giant hardy hibiscus is now blossoming.
Well, you have one little one way back in here.
That's a pink one back there. It's a very pretty one. And it's not as tall as this white one. The white ones, I think, are our tallest. If we want to enjoy that hibiscus, we're either going to have to move it out of there so we can see it better, or I'm going to have to do away with some of this Rudbeckia. I started with one plant. So if you are happy with black-eyed Susans everywhere, just let them go to seed.
Everywhere?
And they will. Yes. Over there. And then these are our allium heads that we will be doing fun things with. We're going to be spray painting these. And they should be very fun. But there's a tree growing there. This is our rose bush.
And look what's still popping out here.
Oh, yes. This will go long. This is damage done by not only the spots here, but also the Japanese beetles.
Those beetles.
Those beetles. And maybe some of the little circle holes are from our leaf cutter bees. That I don't mind. This is one of the shadier parts of our garden. This large maple tree was here when we moved in and continues to do well. But it offers a shaded area that's consistently shady. I had these two plants that were in the house, and while they made it through the winter, they were not happy. None of that greenery was on this croton. It was down to these few oddly shaped leaves right here. Now that it's been outside, even in the shade, it's happy. This is a poinsettia that has, it made it all the way through winter, and now it's flourishing in the summer. So if I want it to bloom, when I bring it in, I'm going to have to hide it in the closet for certain hours of the day and the night. This is our tomato garden this year, and kale. Now, we had a lot of trouble with bugs eating, probably Japanese beetles again, eating all of the leaves. I mean, there were barely any leaves that had nothing. So what I did was I sprinkled diatomaceous earth around here, cut off the ones that looked terrible, and now the ones that are growing again are wonderful. This dinosaur kale is most delicious late into the fall. The cooler it gets, the more sweet it gets. So we want it to last through late fall so that we can enjoy it. Now you might be looking here and think, how do these tomatoes grow in the shade? Well, from sun up until probably 2 p.m, maybe, it is sunny. Sunny, sunny, sunny in here. As you can see, the Roma plums are happy, ready to be picked. And these other ones here, these are not even ready yet. They are growing, but they are still green, green, green. It was an interesting season this year. They started late. Then it got really, really hot, and I'm told that because it was so very warm, some of the blossoms, even though they were on the tomatoes themselves, just fizzled out. So this is like a second crop, even though we didn't get any on the first crop. These are Wisconsin 55. These should be medium-sized tomatoes. They should be this big. They are not this year. So it's just the season.
Well, I know a lot of people ask you about watering.
Yes. We do not water unless we're in a drought time. We can't say that this has been a drought year because there have been times when we've had plenty of water. If we see something that looks like it's really, really thirsty, then yes, we will water. We also water things that we have just transplanted or seeds that we have just planted. But as a whole, no, we usually don't water.
That includes our lawn.
We rarely ever do our lawn. Now these tomatoes, I grew from seeds. So it was months in the making. I had them labeled. I made little stakes, wrote their names down on them, brought them out here, happy as can be. And when I would look to see, well, what kind were these? Because these kind of look like San Marino.
Marzano?
San Marzano. Thank you, San Marino. San Marzano's. Can you read it?
How about the other side? And you even did that with marker?
I did this with Sharpie. Yes.
With a Sharpie.
With a Sharpie. And don't do it. Rick's going to be making me actual permanent ID stakes to put in here. So we're going to find nice pictures, or when these ripen up and we can kind of figure out what they are, he's going to make me some stakes that'll actually go with them so we can tell what they are instead of being mystery tomatoes again.
We're going to have steak and tomatoes tonight?
Ooh, that sounds good. But we have many of them.
And well, you have 50 plants in here and several varieties. I know we did a video when you were actually planting
maybe
them.
We
have to go back to our own video. You know, it's funny when people write to us or comment or something, especially on a video we did 5, 6, 7, 8,
yep,
10 years ago.
Yes, you guys have better memories than we do.
Well, we haven't watched that video in so long, and they just watched it, so it's kind of an unfair advantage.
Yep, yep. Here's some beautiful yellow ones.
Too bad we don't know what they are.
Don't know. They could be Kellogg. We'll just have to enjoy eating them, regardless of what they are.
You got to come over and look at my favorites, though.
Yes. These are Rick's favorite. These are tomato berries. And you can see that they grow in clusters. And the redder they get, the sweeter they get. We have probably sold more of these.
I think we
just by talking about
them. I mean, my goodness. I think people are always asking you, you know, where to get these.
Yes. But you see the beautiful shape to them. You see that there aren't any lying on the ground. They stay on their clump, on their clusters, and they are absolutely delicious. If they get in the house and sit on the counter a little bit longer, they will be even sweeter.
Notice the operative word, if they make it into the house.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. Delicious.
Yeah. They must be. I'll never know.
We just wanted to show you what our Grecian urn looks like at this time of the year. This was amaryllis, so this has come and gone. But because there are moss roses and marigolds around it, it's still pretty. I even put in some Swiss chard that our friend Ranjit gave me, tiny little babies, and I thought, well, we'll put some of those in there and then we can eat them. Ryan, this is your garden art blooming right here. It was filled, circled with liatris. It was absolutely beautiful when they were all blooming. And of course it had bees all around it, and the bees could stop and get a little drink there too. Thank you. This is our little astilbe corner. And while all of these shorter ones have blossomed and I've deadheaded them all, this tall one in the back has not blossomed yet. I'm guessing it's an astilbe. The leaves look right. Why it is so tall is beyond me. I don't know. I guess this is going to be the flower. So we'll see. Interesting.
How about your elephant ears?
Elephant ears, these were some that I saved from last year. They made it through the winter. This is a very dry area that they're in, and still they get plenty of shade, shaded by the house and then by the trees in the afternoon. So it's happy, as are the ones over here. Always fun to see them. This used to be a really shady area when we had our Bradford pear here. Then we had to take that down, and we were fearful that these hostas were going to get all sunburned. But they must get enough shade from the pergola during the hottest times, and then during the really hot afternoons, the shade will creep over here from the trees beyond, and they will get some sunburn, but not totally awful.
And you have been giving your roadies treatment.
I have been treating them.
So it's been paying off.
They look better.
Much better.
Yep. I'm still treating them, so they will get better yet, but I think they're doing much better.
Absolutely.
And as is this one, which I had labeled somehow that this was a butterfly bush. Well, no, it's a foxglove, and it turned out to be a white one. And then this is our fig tree, or fig bush, that we planted last year, and it did very well. And we were really looking forward to perhaps having some figs this year, only to have it chewed down in the winter by mice or voles. So when fall comes this time, we are not just going to protect it from the rabbits and the deer. We are also going to use a hardware wire that will have teeny tiny little holes that they can't get through, hopefully. Many of you might be familiar with canna that grow from bulbs that you have to bring in every year. Oftentimes you'll see the burgundy ones or the green ones. This was a striped orange one that we bought last year, and it didn't do well in the area that we put it. The leaves are beautiful. Even if it doesn't blossom, they're beautiful. If it does blossom, it'll have orange flowers. And then our hibiscus, which have just delighted us for the last few weeks. All the different kinds, the different sizes, the different colors, different textures.
Well, we learned a lot about clematis, and even though we chopped that one back halfway, all the new blossoms are on the top, so obviously this is one that we have to cut back to the almost to the ground.
Right. This one grows off of the new growth, so if we don't want to have all of that brownish, unflowery part, then we've got to trim that back. There are three different kinds of clematis. Some like to be trimmed back, and some don't. So you have to know what kind you have. And since we don't know what kind we have, we've just figured that out from what we see after we have trimmed.
I mean, this midnight marvel bush has just been going to town. Well, all of them actually have.
If you look out the window, yes, it really just stands out. It is such a brilliant red, and the leaves are burgundy and green. They are just lovely. Now, in the past, we've had this, it's called smartweed. And in the past, the Japanese beetles have really decimated this. And we were happy with it because we thought, well, this is fine, it'll come back, it's tough. But maybe they won't eat our other things that we'd like even more. But look at this, they only did this leaf, a little bit on here. And I thought I saw one other one over there. Otherwise, they just left it alone this year.
Well, you always use it as a sacrificial plant.
I do, and yet they didn't even want it this year. They must have found something far more delicious.
Well, they like over 300 different species.
Yes, they do, and you can see on, especially the white hibiscus, they usually have gone after that. They will even go after the buds, not only the leaves, but also the buds themselves. Hold still. Look at that. It's not going to hurt the plant, but it makes it less beautiful, I think.
Well, here's an example of two of them that are mating.
Yeah, there they are. Watch this. No, that didn't kill them, but made me feel better.
And then?
This is Jazzberry Jam. This is the last one to bloom. There you go. Yep. But it's got a lot of blooms on it. So this one should go along for a long time yet. As we move to the south side of the garden, you can see that look at that huge bee. The phlox are coming to an end, and I am very surprised that these did not get powdery mildew on them. Oftentimes, phlox are just as bad as the squash, but for whatever reason, none. Now, we started out with one purple phlox. And I think I divided it once. So we now have it there and there.
And it's also over there. Behind the free book library too, that I can see some.
And there and over there. So it does tend to move itself around. Easy enough to pull out, but very pretty. And it has a fragrance to it that is very attractive. We hope you enjoyed part one of our mid-August garden tour. If you did, please give us a thumbs up. We'd appreciate that very much. And if you have comments or questions, we would love to hear from you. And as always, if you'd like to become part of our garden family, hit that little subscribe button right over here. And stay tuned for part two of our mid-August garden tour. Bye for now.
Connect with us on YouTube and subscribe to our channel.